सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यादिसुतारिणे। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर भवती नैष्टिकी। श्रीमद् भागवतम। So since today is Lord Ramchandra's appearance day, we have selected a special verse describing the purpose of Lord Ramchandra's appearance, and that is from the 9th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th chapter, the pastimes of Lord Ramchandra, text 2. So, can everybody see the verse? तस्यापि भगवान् एष साक्षात् ब्रह्ममयो हरिः अंसांसेन चतुर्धागात् पुत्रत्वं प्रार्थितः सूरैः राम लक्ष्मण भरत शत्रुघ्न इति संगया। तस्यापि भगवानेश साक्षाद् ब्रह्ममयो हरिः अंशांशेन चतुर्धागा पुत्रत्वं प्रार्थितः सुरैः राम लक्ष्मण भरत शत्रुघ्न शत्रुघ्न इति संगया। तस्यापि भगवानेश साक्षात् ब्रह्ममयो हरिः अंशांशेन चतुर्धागा पुत्रत्वं प्रार्थितः सुरैः राम लक्ष्मण भरत शत्रुघ्न इति संगया। तस्यापि भगवानेश साक्षात् ब्रह्ममयो हरिः अंशांशेन चतुर्धागा पुत्रत्वं प्रार्थितः सुरैः राम लक्ष्मण भरत शत्रुघ्न इति संगया। तस्यापि भगवानेश साक्षाद् ब्रह्ममयो हरिः
पुंसांशेन चतुर्भागा पाठिता सुरै राम लक्ष्मण भरत तस्यापि भगवानेश साक्षात् ब्रह्ममयो हरि सांशेन चतुर्भागा
Mataji's.
Api Bhagavan Esha.
Tasya of him, Maharaj Dasharath, Api, also Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Eshaha, all of them, Shakshad, directly, Brahma Mayaha, the Supreme Param Brahman, the Absolute Truth. Harihi, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Amsa Amsena, by an expansion of a plenary portion. Chaturdha, by fourfold expansions. Agat, by the demigod. I'm sorry. Agat, accepted. Putratvam, sonhood. Prarthitaha, being prayed for. Surai, by the demigods. Rama, Lord Ramchandra. Lakshmana, Lord Lakshman. Bharata, Lord Bharat. Shatrughna, and Lord Shatrughna. Iti, thus. Sangaya, by different names. Translation by His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada. Being prayed for by the demigods, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Absolute Truth Himself, directly appeared with His expansion and expansions of expansion. Their holy names were Ram, Lakshman, Bharat, and Shatrughna. These celebrated incarnations thus appeared in four forms as the sons of Maharaj Dasharath. Please repeat after me. Being prayed for by the demigods, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Absolute Truth Himself, directly appeared with His expansion and expansions of the expansion. Their holy names were Ram, Lakshman, Bharat, and Shatrughna. These celebrated incarnations thus appeared in four forms as the son of Maharaj Dasharath. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Lord Ramchandra and his brothers, Lakshman, Bharat, and Shatrughna, are all Vishnu Tattva, not Jiva Tattva. The Supreme Personality of Godhead expands into many, many forms. Advaitam Achyutam Anadim Ananta Rupam. Although they are one and the same, Vishnu Tattva has many forms and incarnations, as confirmed in Brahma Samhita 5:39. Ramadi Murti Shukala Niyamena Tishthan. The Lord is situated in many forms, such as Ram, Lakshman, Bharat, and Shatrughna, and these forms may exist in any part of his creation. All these forms exist permanently, eternally, as individual personalities of Godhead, and they resemble many candles, all equally powerful. Lord Ramchandra, Lakshman, Bharat, and Shatrughna, who, being Vishnu Tattva, are all equally powerful, became the sons of Maharaj Dasharatha in response to prayers by the demigods. Tassapi Bhagavan Esha Shakshad Brahmamayo Harihi Angshan Shena Chaturdhagat Putrattang Prarthita Surai Rama Lakshmana Bharata Shatrughna Iti Sangaya. So, here we can see that how the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, incarnated as Lord Ramchandra. Quoting Sri Brahma Samhita, Srila Prabhupada pointed out that Lord Ramchandra is an incarnation. He is a Lilavatar. And he's also appeared in Treta Yuga. So, Ramadi Murti Shukala Niyamena Tishthan Kala. Kala, Ete Changsha Kala Pungsha Krishnastu Bhagavan Swayam. So, Krishna is the original personality of Godhead and he expands. His direct expansions are known as Amsa, and expansions of his expansions are known as Kala. But there is no difference. Regarding that also, Srila Prabhupada pointed out from Brahma Samhita, Deeparchi Reva Hidasantaram Abhupetya Deepayate Vibrita Hetu Samana Dharma Jastadrigeva Hicha Vishnutaya Vibhati Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. Deeparchi Reva Dasantaram Abhupetya Deepayate Vibrita Hetu Samana Dharma. Just as a lamp is lit by a lamp. When the lamp is lit, it gives out the same amount of light and heat. Samana dharma. Gives out the same amount of light and same amount of heat as the first lamp. But still, the first lamp is the lamp from which the other lamps had been lit. So this is how Krishna is the original Supreme Personality of Godhead who expanded himself into various other incarnations, and there is no difference between Krishna and those incarnations. The same personality expanded with the same amount, with the same potency. He is non-different. Same personality. But he may be displaying different extent of his potency. In Krishna, he is displaying his full potency. As his incarnations, he is not displaying that amount of potency. Krishna is displaying 64 complete kalas, his prowess, 64 qualities, fully displayed. But the Vishnu Tattvas are displaying 60. of these 64 qualities. That's the only difference. Another example has been given in the scriptures. Just like one son becomes many. One son becomes two. Is there any difference between the first son and the second son? No, same amount of light, same amount of heat. The sun, as he expands, he has the same amount of potency. One sun, two sun, four sun, 16 suns. Sun expands in this way. Of course, in this world, there is only one sun, but it's just an example. And Prabhupada specifically pointed out that Ram, Lakshman, Bharat, Shatrughna, they are incarnations, they are not Jiva Tattvas, they are Vishnu Tattvas. Now, what's the difference between Jiva Tattva and Vishnu Tattva? If Vishnu Tattva is the sun, the Jiva Tattvas are the rays of the sun. Minute manifestation of the sun's qualities. Qualitatively, they are one. Sun gives out light and heat. A ray of sun also gives out light and heat. But quantitatively, there is difference. One sun is the source of all the light, whereas a ray just gives out only little bit of light. So qualitatively one, but quantitatively different. That's the difference between Jiva and Ishvara. Vishnu Tattva and Jiva Tattva. Now that Supreme Personality of Godhead performs His pastimes. His pastimes are simply meant for His enjoyment and the enjoyment of those who are also participating in those pastimes or witnessing those pastimes. Just as we watch some show, and by watching that show, we derive pleasure. While I was coming, I saw some billboard displaying some big wrestling event. The wrestlers will be fighting. So the wrestlers will derive pleasure by fighting, and those who will watch the wrestling, they also will derive pleasure fighting. Or similarly, the drama on a stage. The actors and actresses, while they're enacting the roles, they're deriving their pleasure. And those who are witnessing those dramas, they're also deriving pleasure. So Lord's pastimes are something like that. He enacts His pastimes with His devotees, and by enacting His pastimes, He enjoys His devotees who are participating in those pastimes, they enjoy, and those who witness the pastimes, they enjoy, and those who hear about the pastimes, they also enjoy. So His pastimes are simply meant for His pleasure and the pleasures of others. So that is the purpose of His leela. Iti driksha lila bhir ananda kunde shagho shang. Hare Krishna. So, iti driksha lilabhir ananda kunde, shaghoshang nimajjantam akkhappayantam. Iti drik, in this way, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, sha lilabhir, by enacting his pastimes, shaghoshang nimajjantam, he drowns shaghoshang, his devotees. He drowns his devotees in an ocean of joy, ananda kunde. So the purpose of his pastimes is simply to derive pleasure for himself and drown his devotees in an ocean of ecstasy, ocean of joy. And these joys are experienced through 12 different mellows. Out of them, 5 are constant or sthayi bhav, and 7 are secondary mellows or called sanchari bhav. And the sthayi bhav, the constant mellows on which the relationships are based, they are neutrality, servitorship, friendship, parental and conjugal. These are the 5 principal mellows or mukha rasas. And 7 gauna rasas are harsha, adbhut, bir, rodra, vibhatsa, bhayanak and karun. Harsha, laughter or humor. Adbhut, wonder, surprise. Veer, chivalry. Rodra, anger. Bibhatsa, ghastly. Bhayanak, fearsome. And Korun, pathos. So, through these mellows, the Lord with his devotees have his exchanges and he derives his joy. Now out of these 7 secondary mellows, there is one mellow which is called Virarasa, chivalry. The chivalry, mellow of chivalry, is experienced through fighting. So they fight. And through the fight, just as we were talking about, like wrestling bouts, the wrestlers derive joy by fighting. When they have a good opponent, they get beaten to the pulp, but still they derive joy out of it. It is a kind of a mellow, it's a rasa, vira rasa. Now in Vaikuntha, the Virarasa is not available. Because who will fight with the Lord? In Vaikuntha, the Lord is the Supreme Personality of Godhead and everyone is his devotee. So they just, with folded hands, they offer prayers to him and constantly eager to serve him. So how can they ever fight with the Lord? So the 2 gatekeepers in Vaikuntha, they felt Jai and Vijay. They felt that the Lord doesn't get to experience this Virarasa, mellow of chivalry. So they felt if we could provide him this mellow, the joy out of this mellow. And when a devotee desires something, one of the qualities of the Lord is that he fulfills his desire. Especially when the desire is meant to please him or serve him. So, the arrangement was made. The 4 Kumaras appeared at the gate of Vaikuntha. Jai and Vijay, the gatekeepers, failed to recognize their identity as the most exalted personalities in this planet. they obstructed their entry to Vaikuntha because they look like four little boys, 5-year-old boys. In India, often children move about naked. So these 5-year-old boys were moving about naked, although they were one of the oldest personalities on this planet, like Brahma's first offsprings, Brahma's first four Manasaputras, who appeared from Brahma's mind. And because they felt that these gatekeepers judged them according to their external appearance, they became very angry. And they cursed them that you'd fall down. You are not fit to remain in Vaikuntha, the spiritual sky. You'll fall down to the material nature. And then the Lord also immediately appeared to appease his devotees, the four Kumaras. And now the gatekeepers have been cursed, so the Lord gave them, these two gatekeepers, an option. 7 times, come to the earth planet 7 times through 7 births as devotees, or 3 times as enemies. They opted for a shortcut. 3 times, even though as enemy. So these Jai and Vijay, therefore, in Satya Yuga became Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, and in Treta Yuga they appeared as Ravan and Kumbhakarna. And also in Dwapar Yuga they appeared as Shishupal and Dantavakra. So this is how they just came as enemies of the Lord, and to give the Lord the pleasure of fighting. So that fight couldn't take place in Vaikuntha, but the Lord came to the earth planet to fight with his devotees, playing the role of a demon. Again, we can go back to the leelas as drama, like being enacted on a stage. Drama, different actors play different roles. Like somebody may be playing the role of a villain. Actually, drama has to have a villain. Drama means conflict. More the conflict, better the drama. So, the conflict takes place between the hero and the villain, antagonist and protagonist. So, between the villain and the hero, there is the conflict, there is a fight, and the character builds up. That the characters are built up gradually, and then comes to the conflict at the end. So we can see Ravan's character building up. Born in a very exalted family, as a son of a great Brahman, a great sage. But he became a demon. And he wanted to enjoy the universe in such a way that he wouldn't have any rival. Like he wanted to defeat everybody. And as a result of that, in order to get extraordinary power, already he was powerful, but he wanted to get even more power, he performed great, great austerities. He was cutting his flesh and offering into the fire as the offering to please Brahma. according to his calculation, Brahma is the greatest personality. Because in the universe, Brahma is the greatest. So from the materialistic calculation, Brahma is the greatest personality. Finally, he wanted to chop off his head and offer it into the fire. So Brahma just came and asked him, look, what do you want? Please make me immortal. That's the common boon that a demon wants. Make me immortal. You remember in his previous life also he wanted the same thing as Hiranyakashipu. Make me immortal. But Brahma said, look, it's not possible for me to give this boon because I myself am not immortal. In the material nature, nobody can be immortal. Janma mrittu jara badhi is the natural law of this material nature. So, then Ravan said, okay, give him a boon that I won't be killed by any Danava, Daita, Deva. He mentioned everybody that he won't be killed by. But if he just out of his disregard for human beings and animals, he didn't mention their names. He thought, human beings, who cares about them? Because as a Rakshasa, he was much more powerful than any human being. An animal, they're like insects. So these are the loopholes that remains in asking the boon. Like Hiranyakashipu also practically became immortal. But no matter how much he wanted to outsmart Brahma, but the Lord is smarter than anyone else. So he made the condition by which Hiranyakashipu could be killed as appearing as Lord Nrisingadeva. Similarly, here also some loophole is left that because of his scorn for the human beings and animals, don't want to mention their names. And that's the loophole that he left. And he became extremely powerful. He also had the nectar kept in his heart. That also made him immortal. Like, as long as the nectar would be there in his heart, nobody would be able to kill him. Another boon he had, that as soon as the blood would drop, he would appear from that. So in this way, Ravan became extremely powerful. And when people become powerful, they become arrogant. And because of his Rakshasa nature, he didn't have any control over his senses. And he was challenging everybody and defeating them. The demigods were defeated by him. And when he was flying, he actually defeated his brother, his half-brother, Kuvera. And he stole the Pushpak Viman from him, the chariot that could fly. And not only it could fly, it had some amazing characteristics that any number of people could be accommodated in that spaceship. And it was like a flying heavenly planet. And it could move with the speed of the mind. The direction would be given by the chariot driver. In whichever way direction he would want, the chariot would move according to the thought of that. And Ravana defeated his own brother, Kuvera, and stole away his chariot. And Also, he took away his kingdom, which was Lanka, which was originally given to Kuvera by his father. But Ravana took that away from him, a celestial city made of gold. And so while he was riding on the chariot, when he was flying above the Himalayan mountain, he all of a sudden noticed that a woman, a young woman, is performing austerities. Although she is performing austerities in the middle of nowhere, but she was extremely beautiful. Her beauty hasn't been affected by her austerity and penance. And Ravana became attracted by her beauty. And he felt that she should actually adorn his palace. Her place is not in this, in the middle of the mountain valley. So he approached her, asking who she was. And she identified that she was the daughter of a sage, granddaughter of the king, the guru of the demigods, Brihaspati. And she is the personified Vedas, meaning she understood, perfectly mastered all the Vedas. She was an exponent of the Vedic wisdom. Therefore her name is Vedavati. And Ravana approached that why don't you come and be my wife? And she said, look, I decided to marry Vishnu. And that's why I'm performing this austerity, to get him as my husband. So please, leave me alone. You go your way. But Ravan was naturally envious of Vishnu. And when he heard his name, he became extremely angry and he said that, who is Vishnu? I am the greatest, I am the best. So you come to me. And saying that, he grabbed her hair, by the hair. And she immediately just let her hand pass through her hair and cut her hair. And released her from his touch. And she said that because of your touch, this body has become contaminated. This body is not fit to be offered to Vishnu anymore. So I leave this body, but I curse you that I'll come back again and I'll be the cause of your destruction and the destruction of your entire family. Saying that, she generated a fire from within and left her body, burnt the body to ashes. So in this way, Ravana made quite a few mistakes, which actually culminated into the climax. This Vedavati appeared as Sita Devi with an intention to kill Ravana. She didn't die as a woman. She did not directly kill Ravan, but she became the cause of Ravan's annihilation. Another mistake Ravan made was, while he was again passing through this chariot, all of a sudden his chariot stopped and he couldn't understand what happened. In this region, his chariot couldn't move. And then one personality appeared there who had a powerful body with the face of a monkey. So Ravan, so this person told that this is the region of Lord Shiva. Nobody can enter into this region, so please leave. And Ravan insisted, no, who can ever stop me? I am Ravan, the greatest of all the beings. And he said, look, this is the abode of Lord Shiva, who is the greatest. So Ravan derided Lord Shiva. Now, who is Shiva? And he started to blaspheme Lord Shiva. So this Nandi, Lord Shiva's associate, became very, very angry. And Ravan laughed at him, saying, the monkey-faced. So because of this insult, Nandi actually told him that he would be killed by the monkeys. I mean, monkeys would become his greatest enemies. The monkeys would come in huge number with extremely powerful bodies, and they would be the cause of his defeat. And Ravan at that time, not being able to go across the mountain, Kailash, he wanted to lift the mountain. It was extremely powerful. He already had 10 heads and 20 hands, extremely powerful hands. With these 20 hands, he grabbed the mountain and he tried to uproot the mountain. But when he was trying to do that, he did succeed to some extent, but at that time Parvati was sitting next to Lord Shiva, and due to that shaking of the mountain, she lost her balance and she held on to Lord Shiva. She was surprised, what's happening? Lord Shiva said, don't worry, this is this arrogant demon, Ravan. So I'll teach him a lesson. Saying that, Lord Shiva just pressed the top of the mountain with his toe and it crushed Ravan's 20 arms. He started to cry in pain. So his ministers, who are also learned individuals, they could understand what happened, and they said that, look, Lord Shiva has been displeased and that's why it is. The mountain pressed the mountain and that crushed your hand. So keep on glorifying Lord Shiva. So Ravan also was an expert in the Vedic literatures. So Ravan knew the prayers to glorify Lord Shiva, so he started to sing. Incidentally, Ravan is also a great singer. He is an exponent in music. Three exponents of music, according to the Vedic culture, are Lord Shiva, Narad Muni, and Ravana. So he started to glorify Lord Shiva through beautiful prayers sung in a beautiful way. And as a result, and that happened, he was in that situation for 100 years with his hands crushed by the weight of the mountain pressed by Lord Shiva's toe. And then finally Lord Shiva released the pressure and he said, go now. He said, never ever try to display such arrogance to me and my devotees. So Ravan said, okay, from now on I am your devotee. And so while going, Lord Ravan said that, look, I came across your divine grace, so please give me some benediction. So Lord Shiva asked, what do you want? He said, please give me your weapon. So this is how Ravan actually received the Pashupat weapon, which is actually more powerful even Brahmastra. Brahma's weapon is powerful, but Lord Shiva's weapon is even more powerful. Arjuna also received the Pashupat weapon from Lord Shiva. So, and then another mistake Ravan made was, at that time, the earth planet was ruled by king from the Sun dynasty called Anaranya. There are two Kshatriya dynasties. One is Sun dynasty, coming from Sun God, Vivashvan, like you all remember, Imang Vivashyate Yogam Praktavan Aham Appayam. So, the origin of one Kshatriya dynasty is Sun God Vivashvan, and the other is Moon God Somdev. So, Lord Ramchandra appeared in Sun dynasty, Surya Vamsa, in the dynasty of Ikshaku. Manor Ikshaku ve Abravit. So, in that dynasty, and this dynasty is actually, we used to actually rule over the earth planet. And so, the ruler of that earth planet at that time was a king called Anaranya. So, although Ravan considered the human beings to be totally insignificant, but he decided to defeat this, fight with this king, to have his control over the earth planet. And a terrible fight ensued, but the Rakshasa's way were very, very treacherous. They can use some sort of mystic tricks through which they can appear and disappear and do all kinds of things. And being affected by this mystic spell, Anaranya could not really contest with Ravan. And finally, when he was fighting with Ravan, then Ravan hit him with the shell, with the trident, and he laid there unconscious. He fell out of his chariot. When he came back to his consciousness, when he regained his consciousness, Ravan started to laugh at him and started to deride his dynasty. Your family is this, your family is that. For a Kshatriya, this kind of insult is the worst thing that can happen to them, to deride their ancestry, deride their forefathers. So, in response, he told him that in my family, a personality will appear who will kill you. Saying that, he left his body. So, another mistake that Ravan made, when he went to the heavenly planet, he saw an extremely beautiful woman. Her name is Rambha. And he became so agitated by her beauty that he wanted to enjoy her right there. And this lady told him that, look, I am somebody else's wife. And I am actually your nephew's wife. She was the wife of Nala Kuver. Ravan's half-brother was Kuvera, and Kuvera's son, as you know, was Nala Kuver. But in spite of her earnest plea to leave her alone, Ravan molested her forcibly. And she approached her husband and complained what actually happened. Nala Kuver could understand that he is no match for Ravan because Ravan already defeated his father. But Nala Kuver cursed him that from now on, if you try to exploit any woman against her will, then your head will split into 1,000 pieces. You will die. And so in this way, Ravan started to gather a lot of misfortune for himself. And one interesting thing was, Ravan defeated all the demigods. Everyone practically on the planet was defeated. And he was wondering, now who to fight? I don't have anyone to fight with. Just as you probably remember, The same way Hiranyaksha also felt. Who is my match? And when he approached Varundev, Varundev told him that the only person who is your suitable opponent is Vishnu. And he asked, where is that Vishnu? Where can I find him? Varun said that although he is everywhere, but it's difficult to find him. Only some fortunate souls can find him. And eventually Hiranyaksha came across Varahadev when he was lifting the earth from the nether region. Bashuti dashana shikhare dharani tava lagna shoshini kalanka kaleva nimagna keshavadrita shukara rupa jai jagadisha hare. So when Ravan was also wandering around trying to find a suitable match to fight with, he came across Narad Muni. Narad Muni, of course, didn't tell him about Vishnu at that time, but he told him about Jamraj. He said, look, I think he'll be a suitable match for you, the Lord of Death. He didn't tell him that he's the Lord of Death. We told him that he's a very powerful personality. So then Ravan went to Jamalaya and challenged the Jamadutas, and he started to give a tough time to the Jamadutas. Many of the Jamadutas were dead. So here, getting that news, Jamraj came and a terrible fight ensued. And at that time, Jamraj was so angry with him that he was about to strike him with his Jamadanda. Jamadanda means death. Everyone is under the control of that personality. So at that time, Brahma appeared there. He said, look, he is not meant to be killed by you. The Lord himself will come to kill him, so spare him. Don't kill him. Because if you kill him against this arrangement that has already been made, then the whole creation will be destroyed. So don't kill him. So Jamraj then just disappeared. Hearing that instruction from Brahma, he just disappeared from the scene. And Ravan thought that he was defeated. So anyway, this is how Ravan, in one hand, received a lot of bad karma. He is going to be killed by Vedavati, who would appear as Sita Devi. He would be Sita Devi would be the cause. The Lord himself would appear in the dynasty of Suryavamsa as a descendant of King Anaranya to kill Ravana. The monk, the demigods will appear as powerful, extremely powerful monkeys, and they would fight with Ravana's army. And he, from then onwards, after his encounter with, or the curse he received from Nala Kuver, he never dared to touch any woman against her will. So this is how Sita Devi's situation was protected, that Ravan didn't dare to touch her. And so anyway, so this is how the background was set up. The villain has been established. Now the hero has to come. So Dasarath was the king in the Surya dynasty, an extremely powerful king. But he didn't have any son. So, and he was old, and he was thinking that what will happen if I die without a successor to the throne? That's considered to be the most unfortunate situation. So, he asked his spiritual master, Vasishtha, what should I do? Then Vasishtha assured him that, look, some time ago I had an encounter with Sanat Kumar, one of the four Kumaras. And Sanat Kumar told me that you are going to get an illustrious son. Not only one, he'll have four sons. So then on Vasishtha's advice, Dasarath decided to perform a Rajasuya Yajna, horse sacrifice, Ashwamedh Yajna, which is also known as Putreshti Yajna, because this yajna was performed with a desire to get a son. So this yajna was performed, and as a result of that sacrifice, a divine personality appeared from the sacrificial fire, holding a bowl of sweet rice or ambrosia. And he offered it to Dasarath, said, give it to your queen, and as a result of that, she'll get a son. Dasarath already had three queens, Kaushalya, Sumitra and Kaikeyi. So Kaikeyi was the youngest and Dasarath was very attached to her. But Kaushalya was the eldest, so he took half the sweet rice to Kaushalya and he gave other half to Kaikeyi. And they also, Kaushalya and Kaikeyi, they gave a portion of their share to Sumitra. And as a result of that, Kaushalya gave birth to Ram, Kaikeyi gave birth to Bharat, and Sumitra gave birth to a twin, Lakshman and Shatrughna. Now Lakshman became extremely attached to Ram, and Shatrughna became attached to Bharat. And they were practically inseparable. Ram and Lakshman were inseparable. Similarly, Bharat and Shatrughna were also inseparable. So these four sons were born. The king was extremely happy. The whole kingdom was jubilant, ecstatic with this wonderful happening that finally the king got a son. And not only son, so beautiful, so handsome. And as they were growing up, they started to display such wonderful qualities. The most divine qualities were being manifest in their personality. And then they grew up. One day, a very exalted personality, an exalted sage named Vishvamitra came there. Extremely powerful. Like when he appeared into the assembly, it looked like, not only that, when they appeared to the gate of the palace, when he appeared, the guards immediately ran inside to give the news to the king, because it looked like the sun god himself has come down. So brilliant. And then immediately Dasarath came with his ministers to greet this sage, invited him to the court, invited him to the assembly hall, and king made him sit on a throne and sat at his feet and begged him, please tell me, what can I do for you? So Vishvamitra said, look, my business is to perform sacrifices, but these two demons with their associates, Maricha and Subahu, are causing a lot of disturbance. As soon as the sacrifice is about to be performed or about to be completed, they come and contaminate the sacrificial arena with all kind of abominable stuff, blood, pus, urine, flesh, and so forth. So I have come here to help me in getting rid of these demons so that I can peacefully perform my sacrifices. So Dasarath said, sure, I'll go in. He said, no, not you. I want your son, Ram, to come with me. Just hearing that, Dasarath was shocked. He said, Ram, he's just a young boy. He doesn't have any experience, although he has been trained to fight, but he doesn't have any practical experience in fighting a battle. And how is he going to face these two terrible demons? And then Vishwamitra said that, look, I know what I am saying. If I wanted you to come and fight, I would have told you. I don't want you to fight. I want Ram to come. And these demons are the agents of Ravana. Ravana doesn't personally come to desecrate these sacrifices that I perform, but through these agents he is actually doing that. When Dasarath heard the name of Ravana, he fainted. And when he regained his senses, he kept on telling Vishwamitra that, please spare this son of mine. Because he could remember that his ancestor Anuradha was killed by Ravana. So Vishwamitra became so angry that he said, okay, if that is the thing, that means you are not willing to give what I wanted, although you promised that whatever I wanted you are going to deliver it to me, so I am leaving. So at that time Vasishtha intervened. And Vasishtha told Dasarath that, look, Vishwamitra knows what he wants. He himself could have killed all these demons. But he wouldn't do that because he's a Brahmana. But he has the power to kill these demons. So don't worry about your son. Both Vasishtha and Vishwamitra knew who Lord Ramchandra is, but they didn't disclose his identity. Didn't want to disclose his identity to Dasarath. So they told him that, look, let him take him. And the advantage will be that Vishwamitra, who has many power, celestial power and celestial weapons, he will give them to Ram. So on Vasishtha's advice, Dasarath agreed and let Ram go with Vishwamitra. And Lakshman also followed. Anyway, so Vishwamitra took them, and Vishwamitra did give them give Lord Ram these very special weapons and a very special power also. One of the power was that he won't be affected by hunger, thirst and fatigue. Of course, the Lord is never affected by hunger, thirst and fatigue. But these are just the build-up of the drama. So, and then Ram was just with bow, and Ram and Lakshman with bow and arrow in hands. They're just standing guard of the sacrificial area. And when the sacrifice was about to be completed, then all of a sudden they heard this roaring sound, and they saw all these rakshasas coming. And ahead of them was this terrible demon, Maricha. So Ram used a Manavya Astra, the weapon of Manu. And he hit Maricha with that weapon. And Maricha went flying 800 miles and landed in the ocean. Then Subahu came, and Ram used the Agni Astra, and Subahu was dead. And then he used the Wind Astra, Bayavya Astra, and drove away all the Rakshasas. And many of them just died and some flew away. And Vishwamitra, very happy, he happily completed his sacrifice. Now Vishwamitra wanted one thing to happen. He knew who this personality is. Now he wanted him to be united with his eternal consort. And who is his eternal consort? Sita Devi. So he took him to Mithila, the capital of King Janak. And the king, province of Videha. And so there, Janak had a bow called Haradhanu, the bow of Lord Shiva. And Vishwamitra brought Ram and Lakshman to the palace of Janak and told him that, look, I brought these two sons of King Dasarath. They are interested to, they heard about your Haradhanu, Lord Shiva's bow, so they wanted to see the bow. So Janak was very pleased and he told that this bow actually belonged to Lord Shiva. And Lord Shiva then gave this to the demigods, being pleased with them. Then demigods gave it to Janak's ancestor Devarata. When Devarata fought for the demigods against the demons, and being pleased with his valor and being pleased with his support, the demigods gave him this bow. And since then this bow of Lord Shiva is being worshipped in their palace. Once when he was preparing the ground for the fire sacrifice with the plow, then on the edge of the plow, when he was plowing the ground, a beautiful baby came out. And he adopted her as his own daughter and brought her up. And her name is Sita. And he could see that this little girl was not only extremely beautiful, but it was extremely endowed with extremely wonderful qualities. So when she grew up and became of marriageable age, he decided to give her to an appropriate husband, appropriate person in marriage. Therefore, he made a condition that anyone who would be able to bow string the bow of Lord Shiva, he only would be able to win her hands. So with that condition, hearing that condition to win her hands, many, many kings came from different parts of the world. But what to speak of string the bow, they couldn't even shift the bow. They couldn't even move the bow. After all, is the bow of Lord Shiva. And many of them became injured just trying to lift that bow. They broke their back and injured themselves in terrible way. And then these kings became so upset, being frustrated in their effort, that they attacked Janaka's kingdom. They sieged his kingdom for one full year. So eventually Janak actually prayed to the demigods, and the demigods came to fight for him and drove away those kings. So then he was happy that Ram wanted to see, and seeing Ram, Janak also felt a wonderful affectionate feeling towards him, and he wished that this boy be able to string the bow and win the hands of Sita. So the bow, they were taken to the bow was brought out of the chamber into the assembly. 300 men carried the bow on a cart with 16 wheels. And so Ram was very curious. And then Janak said, "Do you want to give it a try? You want to see if you can string the bow?" So Ram looked at Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra nodded, "Yes, go ahead." So Ram placed his left hand on the bow, and to everyone's amazement and delight, he lifted the bow above his head, as if he was trying to measure its weight. And then he strung the bow and he pulled the bow. The bow took the shape of a circle practically and snapped. Such a terrible sound ensued as if thousands of thunder struck the earth planet at one time. Everyone excepting Ram, Lakshman, Sita, Vishwamitra and Janak fainted just hearing that sound. And Janak was extremely pleased. Sita was watching from the balcony above. And she also felt, she also wished that this person could win her hands. An immediate attraction developed. Dasharatha is now happy. He wanted to offer Sita to this prince of Ayodhya. The messengers was immediately sent to give the message to Dasharatha and ask him to come. After 5 days, Dasharatha arrived, and Janak and Dasharatha had a very close discussion. Janak told that how he knew that this girl of his, this daughter of his, is someone very, very special. So he wanted her to marry somebody who is a suitable match. And that's why he made the condition, which meant that her husband had to be somebody who is superior to Lord Shiva. So who is superior to Lord Shiva? So Krishna, Vishnu. So this is why, and this is how he made this arrangement. And so the arrangement was also made that Janak's other daughter, Urmila, would be married to Lakshman, and his brother Kushodhaja's two daughters, Mandavi and Shrutakirti, would be married to Bharat and Shatrughna. So the wedding for the four princes was arranged. They got married with great pomp and grandeur. After spending a few days in Mithila, Dasharatha left for his kingdom. When they were traveling, Dasharatha all of a sudden noticed some inauspicious omens. So he immediately told Vasishtha that, "Look, I see this inauspicious omen." Then Vasishtha pointed out that, "Yes, that's true, but at the same time there are auspicious signs also. The animals are moving on the right side." So, and at that time they saw a powerful personality is striding towards them. He has a bow hanging on his shoulder, and on another another hand, he is holding a chopper, a kuthar, axe. And extremely powerful looking personality. So Vasishtha could identify him as Parashuram. So immediately Dasharatha offered his respect to him and offered his pranam. Then Parashuram, in a mocking way, he told Ram, "Ram." No, he told Dasharatha, "I heard your son has performed some extraordinary feat. So I think this is the this is your eldest son. Huh? So I heard that he broke the bow of Lord Shiva. Okay, so I have the bow of Lord Vishnu. So let's see whether he can string this. And if he can string this, then I'll fight with him. So Dasarath started to tremble with fear, because he knew that this Parashuram has wiped out the Kshatriya dynasty for 21 times. He eliminated all the Kshatriyas from this planet 21 times. He is an enemy of the Kshatriyas. And he became inimical towards the Kshatriyas because the Kshatriyas became arrogant. And here he came to challenge Ram because of his arrogance. He broke he dared to break the bow of Lord Shiva. He thought it was such arrogance. So he wanted to fight with him. And Dasarath was extremely afraid that the consequence of the fight will not be very pleasant. But Ram said, okay, you want me to string this bow? So he took the bow from Parshuram's hand. And Parshuram felt something at that time. He felt that all his energy has been drained. And he remembered that the Lord once told him that after you accomplish your mission, I will come and relieve you from this energy that I have invested upon you. So the Lord who invested the Shakti Avesh to Parashuram, now that Lord has come to take it away from him. So this is how, time and time again, we can see who Lord Ramchandra is and how wonderfully the scene is set to come to the climax of the battle. Like hero, villain and heroine. Now anybody can see what's going to happen. Heroine is going to be kidnapped. And the hero will come and rescue the heroine. The most wonderful drama that can ever happen is enacted by the Lord Himself. Thank you all very much. All glory to Shri Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari. So, thank you all very much. So I'll come again this in the evening. And actually, when they got to know that I'm in Bombay, Brajahari Prabhu requested me to go to